Jackson Park, Chicago, mesto gde je održana Svetska kolumbijska izložba 1893. godine. Izložba koju je posetilo 27 miliona ljudi. Povod je bio proslava 400 godina od dolaska Kristofera Kolumba u Novi svet 1492. godine. Najblistaviji trenuci u karijeri Nikole Tesle desili su se upravo ovde, kada je Tesla osvetlio Beli grad, kako su tada zvali deo Chicaga, na kome se održala izložba. Deo Chicaga u kome se danas nalazi Muzej nauke i industrije nekada je izgledao potpuno drugačije. Zgrada današnjeg muzeja jedina je građevina koja je ostala iz tog perioda.
Dear viewers, we have a pleasure to talk to Vula Saridakis, PhD, curator of the Museum of Industry and Science. It's amazing. We are here today to learn more about Nikola Tesla and the huge exhibit. What was the most interesting things that people really from all over the world came to see?
Yes, I mean, it was attended by hundreds of thousands of people when it opened in 1893. It was called the White City and the City of Lights, because of the lights at night. And it was a series of about 50 buildings and many different houses from all over the United States, from all over the world. People came from Europe and other parts of the world to see what was at the fair. All the latest innovations in science and in technology and industry could be found in the fair. And there was nothing like it ever before. It was extremely popular, and it was called the White City because all the buildings had been painted white. But the only remaining building from that 1893 World's Fair is the one that we're standing in right now, which is the Museum of Science and Industry. But at that time, it was the Palace of Fine Arts, and this was the building that had all the artwork and the sculptures.
Većina zgrada koje su napravljene za potrebe kolumbijske izložbe bile su privremene. Centralni deo kolumbijske izložbe krasio je veliki vodeni bazen koji je predstavljao putovanje Kristofera Kolumba u Novi svet, odnosno Ameriku. Kolumbijska izložba je bila uticajan društveni i kulturni događaj i imala je dubok uticaj na američku arhitekturu, umetnost, američku industriju i imidž Chicaga, kome je pripala čast da bude domaćin. Statua Republike, monumentalna ženska figura, podignutih ruku od pozlaćenog gipsa, visine od 100 stopa, stajala je na istočnom kraju dvora časti. Bila je to jedna od najvećih skulptura u zemlji. Statua je bila visoko cenjeni simbol kolumbijske izložbe, a delo je vajara Daniela Chestera Frencha. Modifikovana, mnogo manja pozlaćena bronzana skulptura danas se nalazi u Jackson Parku kao obeležje velike izložbe. Simbolično nazvana kolumbijskom, izložba je imala svetski karakter i na njoj su predstavljena najznačajnija otkrića. Glavnu ulogu imala je Westinghouse-ova kompanija i Teslin sistem naizmeničnih struja, za koje je ova izložba bila od presudnog značaja.
After had a big competition between Tesla and Edison, Westinghouse and JP Morgan, about who gonna be having the honor to light up the fair.
Yes.
You know, Nikola Tesla was honored with that. How that Tesla accelerated the development of electrical industry in America and the world?
Yeah, that whole story of how the fair was lit is very interesting, because Edison did first bid to light the fair, and he was going to charge more than $1 million, which was way beyond what the organizers of the fair wanted to pay, and Westinghouse gave a bid that was much lower, and so the people here at the fair, the organizers, decided to go with Westinghouse and use the AC type of lighting rather than Edison's DC. And that really popularized AC and made it more likely that people all across the United States were going to use it. And Nikola Tesla was very important in helping develop that AC electricity. He had been working in various European cities before coming to the United States, and then he emigrated to New York, and he worked briefly for a time for the Edison Machine Works Company in New York, but then started working with Westinghouse, who really recognized his talent. And he came up with so many incredible inventions and ideas about how to use electricity and AC especially. And because that was what was used here at the 1893 Columbians Exposition, that's why AC electricity really took off and became a lot more popular afterwards.
Neposredno pre velike kolumbijske izložbe događa se žestoka borba između jednosmerne i naizmenične struje, odnosno kompanije koje će osvetliti izložbu u Belom gradu. Ovaj događaj postaje prekretnica za čovečanstvo u razvoju elektroindustrije. Westinghouse je uprkos Edisonovoj žestokoj kampanji protiv široke upotrebe naizmenične struje uspio da dobije dozvolu za osvetljavanje izložbe Teslinim polifaznim sistemom. Westinghouse, koji je bio čovjek širokih vidika, shvatio je da ako ovu priliku koja mu se sada pružila propusti u žestokoj konkurenciji koju je činio Edison, Teslin polifazni sistem neće zaživjeti. No, to nije bilo nimalo lako. Ugovor je dodeljen Westinghouse-ovoj kompaniji po ceni od $399,000 za 96.620 lampi uz korišćenje sistema za naizmeničnu struju. Ponudio je cenu koja nije mogla da pokrije ni osnovne troškove i svesno išao u finansijski gubitak. Borba Westinghouse-a i Edisona još uvek nije gotova. Pošto je Edison držao sva patentna prava na jedinu lučnu lampu, Westinghouse je znao da sa njim ne može ostvariti nikakvu saradnju. Da nevolja bude još veća, on je morao da patentira novu lampu za samo 11 mjeseci i 8 dana, koliko je ostalo do početka izložbe. On je podigao fabriku stakla i uspio da proizvede novu lučnu lampu koja se sastojala iz dva dela. U ovoj lampi, stakleni deo koji je posjedovao gvozdenu žarnu nit, bio je uglavljen u sjelicu poput čepa, čime je Westinghouse stvorio novi patent i zaobišao Edisonov. Westinghouse je isplivao kao pobednik i uspio je da do otvaranja izložbe 1. maja 1893. godine proizvede 250.000 lampi spremnih za osvjetljenje. Pored ovog imao je i 12 dinama visokih 10 stopa, teških oko 75 tona i konstruisanih na osnovu Teslinih polifaznih sistema. Izložba je pokrivala 690 hektara sa skoro 200 novih privremenih zgrada pretežno neoklasične arhitekture. U potezu pored Michigan jezera danas je tu impozantna zgrada Muzeja nauke i industrije sa malim jezerom, ostrvom i parkom. U sklopu parka nalaze se tereni za golf, marina za brodove i čamce i veliko šetalište. Najpoznatiji arhitekti tog vremena koji su projektovali velikih 14 zgrada smatrali su da je to bio prototip grada budućnosti, dizajniran da prati principe neoklasične arhitekture zasnovane na simetriji, ravnoteži i sjaju. Koristili su se novi moderni materijali i bela boja za fasade zgrada, pa je ceo kompleks dobio nadimak Beli grad. Ovu izložbu posjetilo je više od 27 miliona ljudi tokom šestomesečnog trajanja. Njen obim i veličina daleko su premašili sajmove i izložbe u drugim zemljama i postala je simbol novonastale američke izuzetnosti. Svetska izložba je također poslužila da svetu pokaže da je Chicago ustao iz pepela velikog požara koji je uništio veći deo grada 1871. godine.
Like seeing all those people, you know, like millions and millions of people coming to Chicago. How the visitor, if you have any knowledge about that, any written like testimonial or something, how do people react to all those innovation and all those experiments? Because Tesla was performing that in like the Cohole. So how they reacted to all of this?
What we have are accounts of people, like written records of how amazing all the innovations in science and technology were as they walked through all the different buildings. And this Tesla was in the electricity hall. That's where you would find, actually both Edison and Westinghouse had displays in electricity hall, but Tesla was there performing some of his experiments and using some of his instruments, and people got to see that, and it was just amazing to watch this. It was pure spectacle, because when you see electricity coming off Tesla coils, it's so exciting and interesting, fascinating to watch all that. So people were just amazed by what they saw coming to the fair. And we have here at the museum in our collections department, we have hundreds of souvenirs from the 1893 World's Fair, which, you know, are everybody wanted to get their hands on. They wanted to come here and see all that spectacle.
New York Times izvestio je 1. maja 1893. godine sledeće. Grover Cleveland, miran i dostojanstven, sa nekoliko elokventnih reči izgovorenih jasnim zvonkim glasom koje je čula okupljena gomila, proglasio je otvaranje svetske kolumbijske izložbe i dodirnuo je prekidač od zlata i slonovače. Bljesnule su zgrade, fontane, trgovi, čitav jedan grad izgrađen za ovu priliku. Povodom ove izložbe Westinghouse-ovo preduzeće objavilo je knjigu posvećenu Teslinim otkrićima, dok je cela izložba bila ispunjena Teslinim motorima, transformatorima i generatorima.
How long, you know, took for the AC to be commercially used?
Yeah, there was what was known as the War of the Circuits. Back in the, it was in the 1880s, late 1880s, early 1890s, where you had Edison with his DC current, and then you had Westinghouse and Tesla who were promoting the AC current. And Edison's argument was that it was too dangerous to use AC, too many volts, and it could kill people. But the truth is that AC was a type of electricity that could travel over very long distances and was just more useful, and it made more sense for the electricity provided to cities all throughout the United States. And so while there was this brief war of the circuits between Edison and Tesla, It really began to die down by the 1890s. The fair really created a lot of popularity for the use of AC. And then people began realizing the engineers who were creating these cables and circuits and providing electricity to American cities realized it made more sense to use AC and not DC because it couldn't go long distances. That was the big difference between the two.
Tesla na ovoj izložbi imao zaseban štand iznad kojeg je stajao svetleći natpis "Dobrodošli električari". On je poput pravog čarobnjaka mnogo puta pred zadivljenom publikom ponavljao svoje oglede, propuštajući kroz svoje telo struju visokog napona. U Teslinim staklenim cevima zasijala su imena Faradaya, Maxwella, kao i našeg pesnika Zmaja. Svetski sajam u Chicagu bio je osvetljen reflektorima različitih boja, čija je svetlost treperila na fontanama, presijavajući se u hiljade boja, tako da su prisutni imali utisak da se nalaze u nekom drugom svetu iz bajke. Mnogi su plakali od sreće, a najveća atrakcija sajma tehnike bio je visinski voz na struju. Većina je htjela da ugrabi mesto na čuvenom i ogromnom Ferrisovom točku, čiji je prečnik bio 75 metara.
And tell us how the lighting, the fair with AC influenced the further development of Chicago.
Oh yeah, I mean, people were just absolutely stunned by what they saw. It was the first fair that was lit at night with electricity and with light bulbs. These were light bulbs that had been developed by Westinghouse. He didn't use Edison's light bulbs. And all the buildings were lit up at night. And this was not only a beautiful thing to see, but it was the first time that they were using electricity to light up this fair at night. So just the technology, the innovation, and the beauty of looking at this city of lights at night was really positive, worked really well for the AC electricity. And that's why they wanted to go with it, not only because they saw how well it worked at the 1893 World's Fair, but realized it just made more sense to use something that could travel long distances and provide more electricity to a wider area.
Nikola Tesla izvodio je svoje čarobne eksperimente i mnogi su se tiskali da vide tog maga elektrotehnike kako izvodi čuda. On, obučen u frak sa belom kravatom i belim rukavicama, stajao je kao čarobnjak među svojim magičnim napravama visokofrekventne struje i električnim cevima koje su svetlile bez žica i bez vidljivog izvora. Također je veliki utisak na posetioce ostavilo i takozvano Kolumbovo jaje, koje se vrtalo velikom brzinom na platformi u obliku bubnja. Tom prilikom Tesla je prikazao i prvi električni sat koji je bio povezan sa oscilatorom, kao i svoj prvi kalem sa probojnim pražnjenjem. Obični posetioci nisu imali predstavu o pojavama koje je Tesla demonstrirao, pa kada je svoje telo podvrgavao visokom naponu pomoću visokofrekventnih struja, varnice svetlosti izbijale bi iz njegove figure, tako da su ljudi vikali u strahu od te čudne pojave.
What's happened with all those buildings? They were like not really structured well, or what will happen to them?
Yes, well, when they built the buildings for the 1893 World's Fair, they were all meant to be temporary. And after the fair came to an end, the intention was to tear them all down. So between fires that happened after the fair came to an end and the tearing down of all the buildings, the only one that remained was this one. And that's because this was the only building that had a brick and iron substructure to it. All the others were made out of something known as staff and plaster of Paris. So very temporary materials. But this one was a lot sturdier. And the reason for that is because as the Palace of Fine Arts, artists and sculptors did not want to send their art to a building that could easily catch on fire. They wanted something sturdy and well-protected, and that's why they built this building that way. And fortunately, that's the reason why it remained standing. And it was in the 1920s when the philanthropist Julius Rosenwald came along and said, this is a good building for the Museum of Science and Industry that I'm planning in my head. And they renovated it in the late 1920s and opened it in 1933. And so that's why this year in 2023, we're celebrating our 90th anniversary.
Westinghouseova kompanija specijalno za kolumbijsku izložbu napravila je u to vrijeme najveću električnu centralu višefazne struje snage 9440 kW. Ova centrala napajala je 180.000 sijalica, više stotina lučnih lampi i služila je za pogon vučnih motora, električnog omnibusa kao i za pogon vazdušnih kompresora. Također je ova centrala snabdevala demonstracioni uređaj za prenos električne energije po Teslinom sistemu.
How do people now see Nikola Tesla? What do they think about him? Do they recognize him as an amazing inventor regarding science and electricity and everything, or maybe not as much as needed?
Yeah, well, it seems like after Nikola Tesla passed away in the 1940s, and it seemed for about 20, 30 years afterwards, his name kind of became more obscure. Not as many people knew about what all that he had done for electricity. And then in the last 20 years or so, there's been a resurgence in Nikola Tesla and his work. People have become more familiar with his inventions and his accomplishments, and certainly with the car, the Tesla cars coming around, they too have popularized the name. And people, a lot of people still associate it with a car, but a lot of people, I think, have become curious about where that name came from and might have Googled him or searched for him to find out more about who Nikola Tesla was. And so that was another way to find out more about him. But I think in the last 10, 20 years, certainly there has been a resurgence of interest in his work, and he's given a lot more credit for all that he did.
And that's really great to hear. So like around 2000 innovations, patents Tesla had. We see some stuff here, you know.
Yes.
Could you tell us a little bit more about, you know, what is here? Because maybe some of the things was there in 1900. Let's say if everything was turned off, what Tesla invented, probably we will go
dark.
Definitely dark. So tell us about a couple of things, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Just mention. And we have here like
two. These are AC electric motors, and they're similar to what Tesla invented. He's known for inventing the AC electric induction motor. This is a fan that runs on an AC motor, an example of that. And on this shelf, we have several instruments that are similar to those that would have been used by Nikola Tesla. And in the very back there, there's that column with the coil. That's a small Tesla coil that was around at that time, 1890s, that Tesla was working on the Tesla coils. So that's just a smaller version of the larger coil, the Tesla coil that we have here at the museum that fires off every 30 minutes. So these are all instruments related to Tesla's work or instruments that are similar to those that he had used.
Te 1893. godine Tesla je imao najblistavije trenutke u svojoj karijeri. Dobio je značajna priznanja, održao nekoliko izvanrednih predavanja, a kao vrhunac i kruna tog uspeha, krajem te godine obavešten je o odluci da će se njegov polifazni sistem primeniti na Nijagarinim vodopadima. Tesla je tokom te godine održao i dva čuvena predavanja u Franklinovom institutu u Filadelfiji i drugo u Nacionalnom udruženju za električno osvjetljenje u St. Louisu.
I'm planning anything, if not for 90, maybe for 100.
anniversary?
Oh, we're definitely planning for 100th, so stay tuned. For the 90th, we did have a celebration because the museum had opened in June of 1933.
And Nikola Tesla was represented at that time, right? Did you
yes.
talk about Nikola Tesla then?
Well, we talk about the inventive genius, and he's definitely a part of that story. And we hope, too, that when they come and see that exhibit, guests will also come and see these instruments that are related to his work, and especially that amazing Tesla coil that we have up above.
Kolumbova izložba označila je prekretnicu u razvoju industrije, jer je konačno prevagnuo Teslin sistem ulazeći u široku upotrebu. Westinghouse je triumfovao, a pristalicama jednosmjernih struja zadat je odlučujući udarac.